next 5 o'clock. So let's go ahead and get started. I want to wish you all a very good evening, afternoon, morning, depending on wherever you're joining us from. Thank you all for being here for this latest installation of our Bourbon with Bill webinar series. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Amanda Chun, and I'm just thrilled to be your host for the webinar today. We've done quite a few of these webinars in the past. I have to admit though, that the topic tonight is one of my very favorites that we've done thus far. We are gonna be talking about some of the coolest mechanical marvels that we have in the gallery. These are different works of art and antiques that are imbued with some type of motion. Now, because we wanted to demonstrate that motion for you, we do have a lot of videos in the presentation tonight, so it's best to view it on a larger screen with a good internet connection. However, if you're viewing it on your phone, don't worry, it's still going to be fun. If you need to, you can go back after the webinar and view all of these videos on the respective product pages on our website, msrao.com. So now that we got that technical stuff aside, I did want to mention one more thing. If at any point throughout the webinar you have a question, you can go ahead and ask. We love to take questions throughout. Simply press that Q&A button at the bottom of your screen and type in your question, and we're going to try to get to as many of those questions as we can before the end of the webinar today. Now, without further ado, I would like to welcome Bill Rao. Hi, Bill. How are you doing today?
Amanda, I'm doing great, and I hope everybody on the webinar is also.
Great. Thanks so much for being here. I'm very excited about the topic tonight, so let's go ahead and jump right in, or should I say, jupe right in. Yes, the first piece we are talking about is a jupe table. Bill, this table is so cool. Can you tell us how it works?
Well, this is one of those world's best pieces of furniture, and it's something that's special. So first of all, we've all been at dinner parties, whether it was family or our friends, and sat at the wrong end of the table. I can remember a dinner party after a very long day of business where I got put between a number of ladies that were discussing how to make ice cream for 3 hours. And at the other end of the table, which I couldn't be part of the conversation, was, you know, this very interesting conversation that I wanted to be part of. And the problem with that is every dining room table is basically either oblong or rectangle. And you can have a conversation with anybody that's close to you, but you can't have it with somebody on the other end of the table. The best meals, the best tables, the best conversations have always been around round tables. But round tables have an inherent problem. If they're round and you add leaves to them, it becomes oblong. It just becomes long. This is a table that solved that problem. It was patented by Robert Jupe, and it was made by Johnson and Jeans, who were Jupe's successors. So first of all, I want to let you know that you cannot patent furniture. But this was patented because it has a mechanism that opened and closed to that was patented. So here's a table shown once it's open, and we're going to show the video of it in a few seconds. Here's a table once it's open. If you look at the picture on the right, that's it with smaller leaves in it that would seat basically 6 to 8 people. And on the left, without the leaves in it, but you'll see it with the leaves in it in a second, that would seat all the way from 10 to 12 people. It's just one of the most extraordinary tables you ever see, and I believe that we can go straight to the video. So one person can open it, unlike most dining room tables that you need 2 people, and you put the leaves in, and then once the leaves are all fitted, you close it, and this is the size that would fit 6 to 8, and here with the larger leaves, it would be 10 to 12. Please notice that there's carving on this, and even carving on the leaves that continues to work. And that's both on the big leaves and the small leaves. When you look at this picture, you also see it's the finest Cuban mahogany. This is a wood that basically, I don't want to use the word extinct because it didn't go extinct, but it became non-available about 1845, 1850. And after that, they started using much cheaper Honduran mahogany and Brazilian mahogany. But the Cuban mahogany was always considered the finest. And this is top grade Cuban mahogany. So it's just, to me, the greatest dining room table because it's round, it gets round, it works, it's carved. It's the only carved top one ever made that we know of. Carved base, a ball and claw feet, if you look at it, super feet on there, very much in the Chippendale style. So this is interesting what I'm about to tell you. They make reproductions of pretty much everything that's old, that's great. And there's a company that makes this today. And whereas I would never say this about 99.9% of all reproductions, this is not a table that I would buy a reproduction of, and I'll explain why. That mahogany on that top of that table was left to warp, dry, and twist in a warehouse for a minimum of 2 years before it was used, and maybe even 10 or 20 years. It would have sat there before the artisan that made this, you know, went and picked it out. Today, something could be a tree in Washington State on April 1st, and in your dining room on April 27th. They use chemicals to dry it out and everything, which is fine for 99.9999% of furniture. But because this is mechanical, because it moves, if a new table started to warp at all, and there's a decent chance a new table will start to warp, if it begins to warp at all, it'll no longer work. So this is one where you definitely want the antique for, and this is the best antique jute table that I personally have ever seen.
It's got this great combination of beauty and function, something we all seek out, I think. And this next item, which is an Italian floor space, it really epitomizes that idea as well, with a heavy dose of history added onto it. Bill, can you tell us the history behind this type of safe?
Well, it's extraordinary. So let's talk about the need for safes. Not long after Christopher Columbus, shipping starts to bring money to the New World. And countries go in and out of favor with who's the best at shipping. Obviously, Thomas Christopher Columbus, Spanish were, you know, eventually the Italians became the great merchants, specifically the Venetians. The English eventually took them over with their navy. But if you all of a sudden you're a merchant, all of a sudden you started to make money, you had to have a place to put the money, and people did not trust banks. I mean, I know people don't trust banks today, but compared to 220 years ago, we trust banks 1,000 times more. Banks were just not a safe place to put money. And also, I want to just tell you about something else. We think of a corporation as a normal way of doing business. There were very few corporations 220 years ago. They were partnerships. And so this is a safe that if you had partners, you all wanted to be able to get there. So if you put in your gold bars in there, your gold coins or whatever, you know, your promissory notes or whatever you have of great value, you want to put in some place that locked that. But it was also interesting because this has three locks with three different keys. And you can see this three locks in the upper part of it. You can actually see the three keys on the bottom part. That slides out and becomes, you'll see that in a second. But the three keys are all different if you look at the picture. That's important because all three partners had to be there at one time to open it. So if you had one partner in there or two partners there, they couldn't open it. But these keys were big, and that was the cost of doing business. There were no tiny keys in those days that could turn a lock in a safe that would be secure, because you needed a giant key to be able to turn it, be able to get the torque to turn these giant bolts that were in there. So what would happen? So these keys, as you'll see in a minute, are hidden. You don't see them where they are. But what happens if at night somebody, the night man came in or somebody broke in and found those keys? Because you decided you didn't want to carry them around. Well, they made it. So even if that happened, one could not get in. And now you'll see a video of it working. So Sam right here, he presses a button and the keys actually slide out on the side. Then he takes a pick. And he puts it in an exact spot, only one spot, and the keyhole opens. Then he takes one of the keys, the one that fits in this hole, but he doesn't stick it in all the way like you would a normal key. He sticks it in only part of the way and turns it, and that opens the other keyholes. Then he sticks the keyhole on the top. Once again, he doesn't turn it all the way. He turns it just slightly. And then you can turn it all the way, And that releases the bolt on the inside. He takes the last key and sticks it in, and you see it doesn't turn. But then you take the middle key and you turn it once, and now it will. So you had to have that whole combination. And if you didn't have that extraordinary combination, it just didn't work. These are the type of things that I just absolutely love. We bought it. There was the greatest collector of safes in the world, and we bought a number of his safes, and this was one of them. And I think they're fantastic. People have used them for open them up and put watch winders in them to have their watches in, or red wine in it, you know, to store the wine. Obviously, not too many people are going to use it for gold bars. Obviously, you could use it for jewelry or for whatever you wanted. But to me, it's a piece of art, and it's hobnail all around. And it was made so even if somebody found the keys, they couldn't break in. To me, it's one of the coolest pieces that you'll ever see.
Hey, thanks, Bill. We actually have our first question of the night. Not a big surprise because this piece is so cool. They're wondering approximately how much this weighs.
It weighs about 300 pounds, which one would say, wait a second, 300 pounds, three or four people could come by and drag it off. True. But what these would have done is, if you look at the picture on the right here, you'll see there's a key that's upright. The pick is in there also that he used also to do it first. That opens up and there's a secret compartment behind that, underneath that. But underneath that, there's a base that you could have actually bolted it to the floor. So if you take a 300 pound safe and bolt it to the floor, then there's no way anybody can move it. So that, you know, if you just put one or two bolts in there, and then, so it's, to me, it's a perfect weight. It's something that you could move in your house if you wanted to, yet, you know, if you wanted to make it so nobody could steal it, you can without a problem.
Great, thank you. And thank you for that question. All right, so this next piece, I feel like if I say too much about it, I'm gonna give away the surprise. So I'm just gonna let you handle this one, Bill. It's a mechanical desk by the French ebonist Alfred Bourdelais. Why don't you take it away?
So for a lot of people that love 19th century French furniture, Albert Bourdelais is you know, up there with some deities. He was anything Alfred Bourdelais you ever see, assuming it's in good condition, is always the best. And this was a revival of a desk that's the Metropolitan Museum of Art that's 18th century. This desk is 19th century, by the great Jean-François Aubin. And it represents, let's go to the next picture, represents science and mathematics. So here's the top of it. If you look at the lady on the left, she's looking at the stars, science, and you have the earth in between them. And then the one on the right has a compass in the hand, is doing mathematics. This represent whoever would have had this would have been learned. You know, this is all done with marquetry. The marquetry itself is extraordinary. I think we have some side views. Oh, here's the front view. So the putti on the left are actually, you know, reading a book, and the two in the middle have a sphere, so it represents the world. There's a telescope on the right. If you look right here, this is an artist. This is the artist. You know, the putti is drawing with the easel behind it. Look at on the right. That's a torso on the stand. So the putti is doing the torso. But now let's leave the marquetry for a second. Look at the ormolu. The quality of that is just extraordinary. Bourdelais was amazing. If you have a very good picture, you can actually see little dots on that. Every one of those little dots was put on with a chisel, and there's hundreds of thousands of little dots on there that were put on with a chisel one at a time. The quality of the workmanship of this is just completely unsurpassed all the way around. I think the next is the video. So before you start it, Kristen, I'm going to explain what happened. So, because the video moves pretty quick, there's a secret drawer in here. So when I go, that's my hand right there. When I go to open the drawer, first it'll open a regular drawer, and then you sort of hit the key a certain way and the secret drawer emerges. So we can start. So the drawer opens. If somebody had it, the drawer would open. But if you take the key and turn it, the whole inside comes out. You press a button underneath it and the sides open. The top swivels up for reading a book, but wait, you want to put on your makeup? You could put on your makeup there. The drawers, those are for gold coins, to hide your gold coins. It closes up super easy. Press it down, close the drawer, close the sides, push the top down, and it goes in. And once again, you would never know that it was there. This is one of those extraordinary pieces of furniture that are the best of the best of the best. And I love it because it's something that if you offered me three times, four times what we were asking, we could not find you another one of its quality outside of the one in the Met. And I don't think theirs is for sale.
It's So cool. Everyone loves a piece with secret compartments, that's for sure. We did have one more question about the safe, so let's hop back to that one for a second. How many of these safes were produced? Do you know approximately, Bill?
The answer is nobody knows, because they were produced by small, there was no Rotland safe company. They were produced by small craftsmen, and rarely, almost never signed. However, we've never seen any of these complicated safes. We've never seen more than one of its type. So what we believe is that every single one was unique of this special type. Once you get about 40 years later or 50 years later, you start seeing repeats. But in this period, somebody would have come in and said, I need a safe this high, I need a safe this wide, this deep, it needs to be able to hold this much stuff. And I have two other partners. You know, sometimes you'll see ones with two fancy keys, you know, because you only have one partner. Sometimes you see them with four keys because you had four partners and they all wanted to be there when they were open. And that was the only way that they could trust each other.
Great, thank you. And then do you know the approximate dimensions of this desk, the Bordelais desk?
Yeah, approximately, I'm going to guess, I mean, it's on our website with the exact measurements, but closed, I'm going to guess it's about 42 inches wide. It's probably 32 inches high, and it's probably 26 or 28 inches deep. I'm not far off, but the exact measurements are on our website.
Okay, great. Thank you. And that's msrao.com for anyone interested in taking a look. All right, so this next piece we're going to look at today brings the notion of the art of war to a whole new level. It's a chess set that is based on the ancient Battle of Issus. Bill, there is a lot happening in this battle scene. Can you walk us through it?
Well, first of all the pictures we have, and this is not for lack of trying, it's one that's least representative of how extraordinary this set is. We have two exceptional photographers, and yet we couldn't get this right. And part of it is just you have to see it. So let me tell you about it. First of all, let me tell you about the Battle of Issus. The Battle of Issus was arguably the most pivotal battle in the history of the world. Certainly, you know, depending on your point of view, one of them. It was a battle of Alexander the Great versus Darius of Persia. These were the two great powers of the world, and it was basically deciding whether Europe would be governed with Eastern rules, Eastern values, Eastern thought, or Western thought and Western philosophy and Western values. Alexander the Great won the battle, obviously, thus, you know, the Greco-Roman thought process that a lot of, and values that a lot of us share today in the Western world. And it boils down to this amazing battle. But that's the battle. So let's talk about the chess set. The battle is almost a side note. So the most difficult school of all in the entire world to get into, and I'm drawing a blank on the name, is the jewelry school in Milan. And I know what I'm going to say is probably not exactly correct, but I'm exceptionally close. Whereas, you know, X number of people get into neurological whatever or this rare school at Harvard, they take roughly five students every 2 years, and the students they take are considered the best jewelers in the world, and they teach them it's a three-year program, and they teach them basically every single thing about jewelry. And the people that graduate from there go to the highest paying jobs at Van Cleef and Cartier and to the great jewelers that can afford to pay them whatever. So there was a gentleman roughly 60 years ago, 65 years ago, by the name of Reuven Pearlman. He was this phenomenal jeweler, and he gets accepted to the school. Fast forward 30 years, or 20 years, excuse me, and his first child, a daughter, is born, and he says, I want to make the best piece I've ever made for her. So he takes 8 years, 8 and a half years making this chess set. And you'll see why in a minute. First of all, you can't see how big it is. This chess, most chess boards are, you know, 14 by 14 inches. This is 25 by 25. Most chess boards are half an inch to an inch high. This chess board is roughly 7 inches high. You put any normal size chess board around it, it would look like a, it would look like a jumbo jet next to it, next to a small little prop plane next to it. So he takes 8 years to do it, but he wants it historically correct. But before we get into that, I want you to see, you know, first of all, the board's made with malachite and rhodolite. On the left are the Greeks ruled by Alexander the Great, led by Alexander the Great. They're all on rhodolite bases. On the right are the Persians. They're all led, of course, by Darius, and they're on malachite bases. Those bands around there, those are gold. This is not gold plate. This is made with gold. The bottom is sterling silver and gold, and that's all enameled. But so he didn't want to just make something up. So what he did was he went and researched completely historical figures. On the left is Alexander the Great and Queen Athena. On the right is the winged Persian of God of War and King Darius III. And these are figures of, you know, temples, and that's hard to see. The second one is the ship and the wars and the elephant and other temples. But he took all of these from history, and there's the God of War, and that's from a relief in Iran. This is King Darius, and that's from at the palace in Persepolis in Iran, which we're not necessarily popular people there today, but you know, one day if we ever are, I would love to go because I understand it's stunning. I think we have some more. Yeah, here, you know, here's from the Persepolis also. You can see taken directly from that. Here's a war elephant from an ancient Persian shield, with the war elephant, and you can sort of see the elephant. This, once again, is gold enamel with real gemstones in there. And I think we have a couple more. Oh, here are the Greeks. Yes, this is from Greek pottery. Figures taken from Greek pottery and the ship at the top and how they looked. But the best part was he made them move. And so every single piece moves, which is really hard to do. You can see the video of it. There's Queen Athena. You know, they're dancing in the temple. There's the elephant with it shooting the bow and leading the elephant on the side. This is Alexander the Great. He raises his arm and his sword. There's Darius, raising his scepter. And you can just see the quality of it. It's something it's beyond amazing. The relief, I love the soldier. There's the ship on the right with the rowing. The relief that you see, that's close to 4 inches deep. I mean, so it's completely three-dimensional. It's not flat. This relief is taken from actual carvings, of famed scenes from the ancient world. It is, and I could go on and on and explain why, it is what we consider to be the greatest chess set in the entire world.
Great, thank you, Bill. Naturally, people are asking, how did you come to acquire it?
So it has an interesting story. So this was her dowry, but it had been out just a few times out of the safety deposit, a few times in its life, and those few times, was exhibited at the Smithsonian, it was exhibited at other museums, and then it was put back in the safety deposit box. Maybe 10 years ago, I received a phone call from the daughter, and she said, my father said if I ever needed to sell this, that you would be the person to sell it through. Would you be interested in taking this on consignment? And I had known about this, I'd never actually seen it in person, because when I'd gone to visit her father years before, it had been in the safety deposit box. And I said, I would love to. And we talked about it. And then about 2 days later, she called me back. She goes, I can't. This was my father's gift to me. I can't. And then maybe 5 years ago, she called up and she said, okay, I'm ready. I spoke to my father. My kids are getting ready to go to college. And he said, this is exactly why I did it. Why go into debt to send your kids to college when we can sell this and all your kids' colleges are paid for. So she gave it to us. We sold it right away. We sold it to a good client of ours in San Francisco. He made the semi-fatal error of not asking or telling his wife he was buying it. Let's just say that she wasn't as thrilled with his purchases as he was. When he called us up about a week after he got home and said, could you sell? And we said, of course we could. I mean, it was a great set. I wouldn't mind getting it back. And then he said, let me see if I can talk her into it. And then we didn't hear from him for about 6 months. And we thought that he had actually won the battle, but I think he ended up with like Darius of Persia and didn't win the battle. And called us up and said, would you sell it for me? And we said, of course. And so that's how, so this is the second time we've had the pleasure of having it, owning it and having it, I should say, we don't own it. By the way, we own about 99% of our objects. This is one of the great ones we have on consignment. And I just think it's exceptional.
Great, thank you. And then also, can you remind us what the green and pink colored materials are? And do you know if they're natural to the regions that they represent, Greece and Persia?
That's a great question. Malachite came from Russia and it came from Africa and it's been found in South America. But you know, when you're talking about Iran and Persians and you know, the Greeks, and rhodolite is from the Middle East also. That's the pink. I would assume that both of these would have been somewhere under the Greek Empire or under the Persian Empire. I mean, keep in mind, between the two of them, they controlled 60% of, you know, they controlled 60% of what was known in what we would call, you know, the non-Far East. You know, everything from India over, they controlled 60% of it. Obviously, this was before the Americas were founded. So I would say yes, they were from the region, but I can't swear to it 100% on the malachite.
Okay, great. Thank you. So our next three items are a little bit more in line with what comes to mind when we're considering mechanics and art. These are some clocks. The first is a great industrial timepiece that is modeled on an historic gunboat. Bill, can you tell us a little bit about this piece?
So this is what's known as an industrial clock. And what's an industrial clock? An industrial clock is ones that were made for captains of industry. And who, you know, so a captain of industry, let's say you're in the sugar mill, they may have made you a clock that showed sugar being made. Or, they're all rare, you know, or if you made windmills, they may show you one that had a windmill that turned. And the great majority of those, they made more than one of. You know, there were many people in the sugar mill business, so they could sell the same clocks to the presidents of companies, the owners of the companies, you know, to people that were, you know, very much into sugar. If you were using the sugar mill example, one of my favorites was the machine that put chocolate on almonds, you know, and it was made for the person who had invented the machine that did that and obviously made a lot of money. But the great majority made many of. This is one that was unique, and it was a ship, and the General Artigas was the name of the ship. General Artigas was ordered from the French by the Uruguayan, and it was their first gunboat. And this is basically what the gunboat looked like. We don't know. We've heard two stories, and we can't verify either one. One that it was ordered by the president of Uruguay, and one that it was ordered by the head admiral. We're not positive. But you see like the guns and the turret at the top, and you know. So we're going to have some close up pictures in a second. Here's a close up. There's the turret. You know, with the guns on the side and the horns and the steering wheel on the back. You see the key on the bottom. You know, that key wouldn't obviously, that's in the waves. The key would not stay in there. That's to wind it, to wind the mechanism. You know, there's the lifeboat on the back and the name General Artigas right there. So obviously its name, which is really cool. And here's the video of it. So you can see the turret on the top turns. That right there is a barometer on one side. It's a clock on the other. There's guns on both sides to it would look like. There right there is the video of it of the propeller spinning and so it's just, and it's a good sized clock. It's heavy. It probably weighs 90 pounds or 100 pounds, you know, because that's granite on the bottom, and then it's all silver bronze and black patina bronze and gilt bronze. And so it's just this extraordinary one-of-a-kind clock that's the best there is, in mint perfect condition, working, that's just so much fun to watch. When you wind and put it on the table, nobody walks by without looking.
Thank you. It has this wonderful sculptural quality to it. It's such a beautiful piece. aside from industrial clocks, I think one of my personal favorite types of clocks is the skeleton clock. This example by the Liverpool clockmaker James Congleith is an especially mesmerizing one. Bill, what makes this particular clock so important?
So let's go back to the safe and to, you know, and to a lot of the things that they made more than one of. Clockmakers almost always made more than one of. It was very hard to design a clock. If you design a clock and you laid it all out, you know, an artist once told me, you know, he could do two paintings for the price of one and a half, because you know, it takes 70% of the time the first time to figure out what you're going to do. It only takes 25%, you know, or 30% of the time to actually, you know, paint it. So clockmakers, you know, same way. If you were laying it out, it took a long time. So every clockmaker, just if you had a clock that was successful, you made many of them. James Conliffe was a snob, and he's considered the greatest skeleton clockmaker of all time. He made roughly 70 clocks, of which roughly 40 are in existence still, and every one of them was unique. But so let's talk about skeleton clocks for a second. A skeleton clock is one you can see the bones. Now, that doesn't really, at first glance, doesn't sound that all that, you know, oh well, you know, all you're doing is taking away the wood case. But if you're making a clock and you want to make it accurate, it's not that difficult if you're doing really ugly gears, big things, and hiding, because you don't have to, you don't have to look at it. There's no beauty. To do that same thing and make it beautiful, where the gears are beautiful and they work and everything, you can view everything, is really, really, really complicated. I think, what's the next picture? So on the left, you see a patent detached lever, which you'll see in a second. This was a patented clock because Conliffe was would patent his great inventions. It says Edward Searles on the left, for you can see it. That's not who made it. That's would have been the jeweler who in Manchester who would have contracted Conliffe to do it. More than likely to put this in his window, because when you see it moving, it would capture your attention. So here's a video of it working. So if you can see the detach escapement, lever escapement on the bottom, that spring gets smaller, it gets bigger, gets smaller, gets bigger. The gears are working. If you look at the top, you can actually see the gears, moving in the clock. It's hard to see, you know, necessarily from without taking it out and spending a lot more time on this, no pun intended, than we would care to. Look at the bottom, there's a snake that points to it. A snake, a lot of people are grossed today, are grossed out by snakes. A snake was a very positive, magical sign in the 19th century. This clock dates 1845. Queen Victoria was married within 5 or 6 years of this clock being made, and her wedding ring was a snake. It represented eternal love. It represented eternity because it went round and round and round. So a snake on something like this was not considered negative at all. It was considered a positive. And you know, here's the snake pointing. It brings your eyes to that wonderful detached lever escapement that was patented that the artisan Conliffe wanted you to see. So it's still in its original case. So to find something like this, mint condition, still in its original case. And by the way, that spring, that the silver part up there, that's what's known as a fusée movement. That was like this great invention, not by Conliffe, it was invented before Conliffe, that made clocks tell accurate time. And it basically was able to give an accurate pressure. Not most clocks, I'll see if I can explain this real quickly. Most clocks, if you wound it, Before the fusée spring was invented, they would have been faster in the beginning because there was so much pressure on the spring, accurate in the middle, and slower at the end when there was less pressure. This evened it out, so it became an even feel, an even timekeeping for the whole way. So it's just it's a fusée movement skeleton clock by the best maker in great condition, original case, patented. It's just a joy to look at.
I will add, if you're interested in learning more about clock movements, you can check out our Time Across Time webinar on YouTube. It dives a little bit more into the difference between a fusée movement and a more traditional movement. All right, so let's take a look at one final timepiece, this one that doubles as really a living work of art. Bill, there are a lot of elements at work in this French musical picture clock. Can you walk us through it?
Yes. So I think 98% of the people, they saw this in our gallery, they would automatically assume that the part at the bottom is a painting. And it is, but it's more than a painting. And whereas we call this a clock, the clock is almost the most insignificant part of it. Whereas, you know, the clock, which we just spoke about, was so, the movement was so important. This clock is just part of the decoration. Now, I want to give you a grasp of the size. This is roughly, I'm guessing, 42 inches wide, maybe 40 inches wide, and maybe 46 or 48 inches high. That's big. And it's something that's extraordinary. I think the next picture shows the inside, if I'm not mistaken. Oh no, this is close-ups. And you can see them, you know, to see them making the horseshoes and putting the horseshoe on the left. In the back, you can see the bay with the women washing and, you know, man fishing. We can go to the next picture. This is the movement. So this is the clock. That's the music box on the bottom right, which plays music. And those round things are the chimes. So it has different chimes that would dong, ding, dong, you know, depending on the hour. So this is a clock that, this is a painting that sat on your wall. And then the clock would strike whatever hour it was, 10 o'clock. And I'll show you what will happen. So hopefully you can hear me over the music. You can see they're hammering and they're making the horseshoes. They're putting the horseshoe on. Look at the man on the right. He's actually doing the bellows for the fire. He's pulling it. The man on the left, he's putting the horseshoe on. The dog's wagging its tail. In the back, the women are rubbing the clothes against rocks. It is just the most extraordinary thing when you see, because it shocks you, because it's all three-dimensional. You see the windmill all the way on the left and the water wheel also in the middle and the back. It has so many moving parts that you don't even notice. The horse head moves on the left, which you don't see right there. Now you see it. It's just, it's awe-inspiring. It came from one of the great collectors in the world, a gentleman by the name of Larry Claremont. Many people in Chicago know who he is, the Claremont Coin Car Museum. Larry was a Iwo Jima a veteran, hero of the war, and he lived to be 96 or so. And we bought this from his collection. It's just as extraordinary as one will ever see.
Absolutely delightful, that's for sure. So we heard a little bit of music in our musical picture clock, but these next items that we're going to see tonight are really dedicated to the art of music. Now, I think a few of you have been to our gallery before. You almost certainly have witnessed a demonstration of one of our fabulous automatic music players. This one, which was made by the Chicago-based Mills Novelty Company, features not one, but two automatic playing violins. Bill, would you mind virtually demonstrating this for us?
Well, I will. I wish I could play a violin, but this is the closest I'll ever come. So let's talk about this one for a second. I love the statistic we're about to tell you. In 1910, the United States government labeled this machine, this is 1920, by the way, but labeled this machine as one of the 8 greatest inventions of the decade. So from 1900 to 1910, the United States felt this machine was one of the 8 greatest inventions of the decade. Now, if you think about it, most musicians will say the hardest instrument ever to master is the violin. And so when this machine finally mastered violin and got all, you know, not only the notes, but the nuances and the feel right, it was considered amazing. It just blew people away that something could play a violin like this. So they made a number of single violins. Sadly, the great, 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 great majority of these have been abused over the years, you know, and, you know, or had, you know, Bob who fixes the car come and try and fix it and ruin it. But very few of them have survived, but they only made a few, just a handful of double violins. And a double violin was especially good because it could play together or it could play like dueling. And you can see, look at the quality of the workmanship in there, you know, in the violins. And so when this plays, I'm going to talk for a second. You're not going to be able to hear me, so I'll be quiet while this is playing during the video. Well, there's a picture of the whole mechanism. So let me say this. Originally, if you look at the brown part in this in the near the bottom, that's a roll. It would have played on a paper roll. But this has been upgraded. This has been upgraded to a system that now plays on a little computer or an iPad or your phone. And all you have to do is, and it comes with thousands of songs. So you know, now you can get everything from Bach to the Beatles. And because it's electronic now, which you'll see, because it's electronic, it's even better because it originally it would have played one song and then you had to change the role. Now you can say, hey, I'm having a dinner party. I want to play these next 40 songs for the next 2.5 hours during my dinner party. Poof. That, you know, it would play for 2.5 hours and you could have whatever music you want. I believe the video is next. Oh no, there's the coin op, because obviously this would have been in a commercial place and it would have cost a nickel to listen to it, which was a lot of money. But here's the video and I'll be quiet now. So I mentioned that it played from Bach to Beethoven. Well, we mean from Bach to the Beatles, and we obviously Eleanor Rigsby was I don't think the Beatles had written it in 1920. But it shows that even a modern song that they can take and make it sound extraordinary. And it comes with thousands of songs. So whatever music you like, you would certainly love this. I don't know if you noticed in the back, the piano playing. So this is piano and a violin. So, but it's really great because the piano is upright. Whereas obviously 99% of pianos we've ever seen are horizontal. This one's vertical, but the sound is the same. And they made it so the bass notes, typically, the reason why pianos are longer on one side is the bass notes are one side and the treble notes, which are shorter on the other side. You know, the bass notes are in the center of this. Now, that would never work if a human was playing it because they would never figure out what they were, where to put their hands. But obviously, with a machine playing it, it's great. So this is one of a handful of known double violinos. It's been completely restored, so it'll play perfectly. And it's ready to go, and whatever music you like, you can listen to.
Great, thank you. We do have a question about this one. What do you do when this needs service or repair?
There are a few very great specialists on these. It really should need service for a long. There's service and repairs. There's minor things that you can do as far as putting like I can't think of the name. It's a powder type thing on the part that hits the strings. I can't think of the name of it that you can do. There's a few things that you can do yourself, but if you don't want to do those, there's a guy that comes around the country once a year and he'll do all that for you. And that's all really you need to do. Sooner or later, it'll break probably in 30 or 40 years. And then, you know, it shouldn't break anytime before then because it's all been restored, but it's all restorable. This is something that there are people, the right people can fix it without a problem. And because it's been restored, really very few of the people that are on this call will live to where it needs its next restoration.
Okay, great. Is it difficult to tune?
No, it's actually pretty easy to tune, crazy enough. And it comes with, you know, if you get a, I don't want to get too technical. It comes with a little machine that will tell you when it's in tune. So you don't even have to have a great ear. You know, that should be G, and it'll tell you, yeah, perfect G when you do it. So it's pretty easy. It's not complicated.
Okay, great. And then one more here. Back when it was still a role system to play music, how easy was it to stop and change those music roles?
Well, you wouldn't stop it in the middle. You had to wait for the end of the song. It was not difficult. It wasn't difficult. I wouldn't necessarily, if you saw me do it, you could do it yourself. But to change a role, you know, they're big and clunky. You didn't keep it. You know, you'd have to go find another role. It was probably, you know, a 6 or 7 minute job. And some of these roles played one song, some played two, some played three, but that was it. You know, so if you listen to the songs and, you know, and you wanted to go find another role and they had to be labeled, it was difficult. The system that's mechanical, I mean, this electronic is so much better. You know, so it's taking the best technology from 1920 and matching with the best technology from now and really bringing out the best of both.
I know my kids would be playing Coco Melon on it. So it's, you can do anything you need. All right. So now we're going to look at something a little more old school. This is an example of an earlier Swiss cylinder music box. Bill, can you tell us a little bit about cylinder music boxes in general and then specifically about these station music boxes?
So the silver piece in the center there is the cylinder. And the cylinder was the first music box that ever reproduced music. What do I mean by reproducing music? Music that could be played by itself. In other words, there were machines that were made that played music. In other words, you know, something, you know, that you'd be pressing on your feet on something and its hand would be hitting a, you know, a thimble or a drum or whatever. Those had been around a while, but that played music, but you couldn't reproduce music. So a cylinder music box was invented, give or take 1800, 1795 to 1805. And they've got better and better. And somewhere around 1890, about 1880, they perfected it. And now what a station box was, this is the shape of a station box. This is an upright box. Most boxes you would look down into. This one was straight up, so you look straight into. And it was, these would have been put in train stations for people to put coins in. However, this one was never in a train station. We know that for a few reasons. First of all, I mean, there's many reasons. First of all, it's too good. And that's really the most important one. Second of all, it's a Circassian walnut. Circassian walnut was always really expensive. This is the wood that that's found in Rolls-Royce dashboards today. It came with extra cylinders. There would be no reason for extra cylinders if somebody was just waiting for a train and decided to listen to, because each cylinder plays six tunes, there'd be no reason to do it, you know. And lastly, which seals its fate as something made for home, there was no place to put a coin. So this was a station box done in the style of a station. You can see the dolls and the butterfly in the center. Look at the cylinder. This is important. The cylinder behind that, that's a mirror. So that's just a reflection. You see those lines that go all the way around the cylinder? Between each one of those lines is six different songs. And so what would happen, and those are little, those pins in there were put in the exact right spot. How they did it, I have no idea. And then between songs, it would move over maybe a 64th of an inch to line up with the next one. So those pins would hit the teeth that are down below. The teeth look like the comb. It's called a comb also, for your hair. And the teeth look like a comb, and those little pins would hit that, and that's which would play the music. And I'll be quiet during this so you could listen. Well, there are the extra cylinders that are in the drawer, so which is very rare to find extra cylinders. Now we can watch the video and I'll be quiet. So the song was one of the most popular songs in the West, well, in the English world, The Last Rose of Summer. And if you think about 1890, this is the first period where the super wealthy started to have home. They had made their money in the cities, but they started to have their homes, whether it was in Newport, whether it was in the Jersey Shore, whether it was in, you know, Bar Harbor, Maine, or in other places, and they would stay there throughout the summer. And you know, so imagine, you know, somebody who's had their whole family and been, you know, swimming and enjoying themselves all summer, and all of a sudden you got to go back to work, you got to go back to school. That last rose of summer would have meant a lot more to most people. But this is an upright machine. I'm guessing it's 6.5 feet high, you know, with all of its finials, and at the top, it's just stunningly beautiful. It's as good of a music box as one will ever see.
One of those that just brings a smile to your face, that's for sure. One question here, Bill, is it possible to purchase additional cylinders for these music boxes?
That's a great question, and the answer is no. So there were thousands and thousands of hours put into making each cylinder. I'm willing to wager on that cylinder we just saw, there may be 20,000 pins in there, and each one had to be the exact spot, not close, the exact spot to hit the note in the right spot at the right time of the song. And that was just mind-boggling expensive. So I'll share something with you, which is sort of interesting. Cylinder music boxes were replaced by disc music boxes, and disc music boxes did not sound as good, but they had two advantages. They were less expensive to make, and you could buy new discs. So if, you know, a new hit song came out, John Philip Sousa comes out with a new hit and you want it, that one there, you could go buy it on a disc box. But disc boxes didn't sound quite as accurate as a cylinder box. They were put out of business by the Edison talking machine, the Victrola. The original Edison talking machines didn't sound anywhere near as good as a disc box, but it put them out of business because they were far less money to make and they could reproduce voice. Even though the voice sounded terrible, they could do it. So it's interesting to me that each successive one sounded less good, less perfect than the model it replaced.
Thank you. Just a few more questions here. How heavy do they normally weigh? And I'm not sure if this is referring to the cylinders or the boxes, but...
They're heavy because the bed plate that they're in is heavy. The cylinders were heavy. The cylinder by himself, like the cylinders in the base, I think it comes with four cylinders. They probably weigh 20 pounds each. I mean, the whole piece probably weighs 120 pounds, 140 pounds. That's a guess.
Okay, great. And then, do you know if the dowels and the butterfly at the center have any significance?
It was just a way of entertaining. To have something that was moving. We look at this and go, that's very cute. But, you know, imagine, you know, somebody who's really never seen any automatons before, anything move. You know, they didn't see the figures jump up and down. They didn't see them move. They have never seen. So when you see something like that, it's like, wow, that's awesome.
Great, thanks. So you talked a little bit about disc music players. This next piece that we're going to see is an example of one of those. Bill, can you go ahead and explain to us how this works?
This is one of the king of disc music boxes. This is a polyphone auto change tubular bell music box. So there were a number of people that made the disc boxes, but there were three main groups. Those three groups were Polyphone, Symphonia, both of them were in Leipzig, Germany, and Regina, which was in Rahway, New Jersey. Regina was actually started by Polyphone. They sent a gentleman that worked for them over to America to start the company because they realized that, with a whole bunch of reasons, they realized the market in America was so big. And also, if something was manufactured in America and wasn't imported, they didn't have to pay tax on it. So a disc box, disc came in a whole bunch of different sizes. This is a large disc. Large disc. The sounds to be much richer and much longer. Obviously, the smaller the disc, the shorter it plays, the larger the disc, the longer it plays. But this right here is also an auto changer. So this is one of those really rare ones where you could say that's you can see the movement on the right better. Pick up the disc, play it, put it down, and pick up the next disc. Look in the upper top of the music box on the right. Those are bells. Bells, where bells are rare in cylinder boxes, They're almost unheard of in disc boxes. So this is like one of those ultimate machines. And I believe we have the video next. I'll be quiet so you can listen. So that's really, really cool. Please believe me that this and the one before it sounds so much better in person. We actually experimented a whole bunch of different ways. And every time we got it where it sounded good, we tried it on the Zoom and we were worried that we would blow out some people's eardrums. It was so loud. And so it's one of those machines that just resonate music throughout the whole room, but they didn't reproduce on the Zoom anywhere near as great as they sound. The bottom of that one, you see how it pulls out. That's important. That's where you carried extra discs. So you could, you know, the top holds 12 discs, or excuse me, 6 discs. But if you want to put another 20 or 30 below it and change those discs out every now and then, very easy to change out. And once again, you could say, I want to play all 6 in a row and they'll play it, or I want to play one of them 3 times in a row and it would do it.
All right, great. So we're going to wrap up our presentation of musical antiques with a player piano by the American company Steinway & Sons. This is a machine that's as mechanically advanced as it is just visually stunning. Bill, what can you tell us about this piano?
So let's start by saying that concert pianists will state, the majority of them, everybody has their own opinion, but the majority of them will state that the greatest pianos ever made were made by Steinway between 1880 and 1929, 1930. Before 1880, 1879, 1880, the technology wasn't there to make a perfect piano. 1929 or 1930, the Depression comes, and Steinway, along with everybody else, has to start making it less expensive. So they start cheating. Instead of the soundboard being 2 inches thick, they make it 1 inch thick, and the sound is not as great. So you have this piano was made in the perfect golden age. It was made in 1920. So that's the first thing. So what can make a, you know, so, but 99.9, Steinway made the best sounding pianos in the world. But for a general exception, for just a few general exceptions, they didn't make the prettiest pianos in the world. Some of the ones made in France and Germany and in England, they were much more decorative. You know, Steinway was a great place to go buy a piano that sounded great, but you know, they were nice. You know, if you wanted, they were either walnut or mahogany or ebonized, but you know, it had maybe a little carving on the legs, but nothing special. But they had wonderful clients. And somebody said, I want a great one. They would do something what's known as an art case, where they would make a piano that was completely unique, that was all decorative. And look at the cupids on there, even underneath the top, that, you know, and the carving, every bit about it was just done to perfection, and it was unique, and it was made for the person it was ordered for. And this one was actually made by Barney Kroger, who Kroger grocery stores. And my father told me many years ago, he said, the grocery business is never bad because people have to eat. Eating never goes out of favor. And Kroger was one of the great wealthiest people of his age. And of course he had Steinway make it. We have other pictures that are close-ups of this. You know, that's a top view and you can see it's perfection. And that's with the top off. So you can see it and the bass strings on the left and the treble on the right. There's the front view and, I think we have one more close-up, don't we? Or is that next to the video? So before you play the video, I need to tell you the next part about it. So first of all, art cases. Very few of them made. There's one in the White House. There's one in the Smithsonian. I'm trying to give you all of them different, all of them unique, none of them the same. So they were the best. If you can get an art case piano from 1880 to 1929, you've got, by Steinway, you've got the best piano in the world. but what could make it better? Around 1910, 1915, a company called Duo Art invented what's known as the reproducing piano. A reproducing piano is a piano that not only, we've all seen player pianos, but a reproducing piano is a piano that actually reproduces the sound as the artist intended. What do I mean by that? They would use the pedals, they would use the keys. So sometimes the artist would hit the keys very hard, or sometimes he would hit it very soft. And that way, a player piano wouldn't know that, but this would reproduce the sound exactly as it was intended. And when they came out, they actually had famous pianists go behind a curtain in front of the audience, and they would have the piano play itself and the artist play, and they would ask the audience which one was which, and nobody knew. You could not tell the difference. So once again, just like on the violin, you had rolls. The rolls were not as good, especially on this. They only played one song. They've come out what's known as a QRS system. For now, on your phone or an iPad, you can once again get any song you want, and whether modern or antique, and play it. And now you're about to hear, which it's about a Steinway Duo Art from the best period, in an art case specially made and with the newest technology, and you'll hear it now. That's the end of the piano. You saw in the previous picture, it comes with a bench. I also want to let you know that's very rare. Piano players play it on a stool typically. Benches were rare. Today everybody wants a piano bench. In those days, they wanted a stool. And so to find one with its original bench is exceptionally rare, but that's almost a side note. The piano itself is so extraordinary. It's better than the one in the White House. It's better than the one in the Smithsonian. And that's a lot to say. And we know exactly when it was made. We have Steinway's records of when it left the factory and who it was made for. So it's just superb.
Great, thank you. So a quick question on this one. Do you know about how much it would have cost at the time it was commissioned?
A lot. That's a great question. Whoever asked that question, if you could send your email address, I will let you know. I know we know, but I know I have that information, but I don't have it stored in my head.
Okay, great. So we do have one more item we're going to look at tonight, and someone in our chat already guessed what it was. It is a stunning example of a singing bird box. This piece really exemplifies the idea of the art of motion. Bill, can you demonstrate how this works for us?
Certainly. So first of all, I want to apologize for this going on and on. It's longer than it's the longest one we've ever done, and it wasn't our intention, but I get excited about these things also. So what comes first, form or function, right? And so tobacco is brought to Europe and becomes popular, but it's expensive. And then it turns into snuff, where people would snuff tobacco. But snuff tobacco is really expensive. So only the very wealthy could have snuff. So if you had snuff, you had to have a place to do it. And the greatest one-upmanship of all was to have a gold box that you would put your snuff in. So imagine, you're walking down the street and you go, Bill, would you like some snuff? And you take out your gold box, and it's really nice. Of course, me being me and, with all the boxes we have, I pull out mine and go, no, have some of mine. And my box is so much nicer. I was one-upping you. And so imagine just for a second, somebody comes out and says, take some snuff of mine, and all of a sudden a bird pops out, and you're going to see the bird moving and singing in a second, and how much that would have blown people away. Now, before you ask, no, this one never held snuff, but it's the exact same shape and it looks like a snuff box. So it's something that you would see, but what's really, really, really rare about this is that it's made of 18 karat gold. When this was made in the 1840s, all the gold in the entire world would have fit all the known gold in the entire world would have fit into one Olympic-sized swimming pool. Think about that for a second. This was extraordinarily rare. Maybe one-tenth of a thousandth of every, you know, automaton, bird box, whatever, was made in gold. Exceptionally rare, and it was made by Bruchère, who was one of the two most important makers, the other being Rochat. Once again, see all those dots in there? See every mark in there? Every bit of that's done by hand with a chisel. There's nothing on there that's machine made. Every bit about it is beautiful. So you have this solid gold box. And now we'll see it. Well, before we see it play, before you see it, I want to tell you a story. My father leaves me alone in the gallery for the first time. I'm out of college. I'd been working there part-time for years, but okay, he trusted me. And I get a call to go see a bird box. I don't know anything. My father's on a cruise, can't reach him, obviously long pre-cell phone days. I can't reach him. I don't know what to do because I don't know what a good bird box is. And I'm quite green under my gills. And I remember calling a friend of mine, Johnny, in England. I said, Johnny, you know, I'm going to see a bird box. He goes, well, it should be in a pretty case and it should, and the bird have should good movement and it should have flaps and it should sound good. And he's going on. And everything is subjective. You know, would it sound good? What is good movement? None of this. And he goes, but let me tell you a secret. He goes, all the good ones had real hummingbird feathers. And I remember snapping at him. I said, wait, how the blank am I supposed to know what a real hummingbird feather looks like? I'm from New Orleans. I don't know what hummingbirds look like. And he goes, no, you'll know. They have iridescence on their feathers. You'll know when you see it. And I was utterly convinced that I wouldn't. I remember going over the house at night and turning it on. And there were real hummingbird feathers. And I knew it. And I knew that it was a good box to buy. So this is a great one. Obviously has real hummingbird feathers. And you're about to see it. Well, as you can see, it's great. And so let me share one other thing with you, because it's running late. There were two types of these boxes. The earliest ones, including Bruchère and all the earlier ones, they were made with a fusée movement, the same movement that we saw in the conleaf clock with the spring that's long and wound it. Then they invented a spring that was far less money to make. And all the bird boxes post this were made with the less expensive spring. The less expensive spring, the bird doesn't play as long. Its head doesn't turn. It doesn't have the movements, couldn't do all the things, but it was so much less expensive to do that it, once again, even though it wasn't as good, it was so much less expensive to do. It overtook these. So this is a bird box from the best period by the best maker in gold, in perfect condition, and we just love it.
Great, thank you. So we do have a few questions about the box, and if you have any more, feel free to send them in. Bill and I can stick around for a little bit longer. We saw a little bit of the scale with the video with the hands that came in, but can you tell us the approximate size of the box?
Of a bird box?
Yeah.
They're not big. I would guess 4 inches, 4.5 inches wide, maybe 3.5 inches deep, and maybe 1.5 inches high closed. Maybe 50% or 60% bigger than a carton of cigarettes. My mother smoked, you know, so I know exactly how big cartons of cigarettes, not cartons, packages of cigarettes, not a carton, excuse me.
And then do you have any idea about how long it would have taken for a box like that to have been created?
Oh my God. You know, I mean, there were tens of thousands of man hours in that, because just the case alone, there were thousands of man hours, and that has nothing to do with the mechanism. So yeah, I mean, tens of thousands of man hours to do it. It would have been extraordinarily expensive. I mean, you know, to have a gold bird box, that was just, I mean, the ultimate.
Great. Thank you so much. And I think that wraps up our questions for the evening. So we're going to go ahead and say goodbye. I do want to say, after this webinar ends, you're going to receive a link with all the videos from tonight's webinar, just in case you would like to view them again in some more detail. You're also going to receive a link to a survey. So please go ahead and take the time to fill this out. It really helps us to plan for any future webinars. If you have any ideas for us for topics, we also welcome those. Thank you again, Bill, for being here. And thanks to all of you who attended. Please have a good night.
Good night.